Hello and welcome to DDOCast episode 467, recorded live on Sunday, March 19th. I'm your host, Patrick. With me this week, we have returning from the High Lords of Malkir on Sirlona, Voodu. Welcome back.
Hey, everyone. Thank you.
Yeah, good to have you back. We also have from the Guildless Guild on Kyber, Arkat.
Good morning, everybody.
Yes, good morning indeed. If I seem a little bit draggy to the listeners, it's very early in the morning, and I had a very long day of standing in the sun and the rain and the cold umpiring last night. So not fun, but I'm a little tired. In any case, we're here to talk about DDO, which will be awesome and a lot of fun. We'll start with the screenshot of the week, which is a very different screenshot. It's very dark. This is from Nervgen, finding an abstract place to post a screenshot in the 309th screenshot of the week. I'm going to guess that that's in Rainbow in the Dark, because that's about the only place I can think of to find a place that's that dark. But there's probably other places, so. All right, do you guys have any ideas on where that is?
I wasn't sure when I looked at it. Thought maybe it was just some sort of weird angle display bug.
Yeah, I don't know. It's unique. We'll go with that. We like to talk about Dungeons & Dragons online nearly every weekend. You can catch us through Twitch, YouTube, the DDO forums, iTunes, or from our website at DDOcast.com. DDOcast is hosted by Cyber Ears, the awesome podcast hosting network. Shows are usually available within a few days of recording, and the next show will probably be next weekend. You can stay updated by following us on social media pages, our website, DDOcast.com. We have a calendar. Twitter is really kind of the best one. Sometimes I forget to post on Facebook, but I always post things on Twitter. That's the one place I'm the most consistent about doing that. So, on the podcast this week, we talk about a little bit about update 35 came out this week. Was it last week? No, it was this week. Or was it last week? I can't remember anymore. There's some stuff about update 35. There was a hot fix this week, and we can talk a little about that. Some other stuff from the devs. But our focus this week, we're going to be doing another debate episode. And we're going to be talking about some questions that were submitted by the listeners. It was really kind of the theme for this week. Did our survey recently, had a lot of fun questions from listeners to kind of talk about and really kind of dive into. So that's what we're going to do today. It should be a lot of fun. So what we're going for is we're going to try to be kind of somewhat spirited. We're not going to be too adversarial. We're not picking winners anymore. But we're really going to get into these questions and talk about some ideas and that kind of stuff. And have a lot of fun. That's the one, because we like talking about DDO. And our first question, and this comes from Civic Spoon on Galanda, is what storyline should be continued? And then, because, you know, don't want to just stop there, we're gonna pitch what gets continued. Voodu, why don't you kick us off here?
Oh man, you're really putting me on the spot. Okay, so I'm gonna go with the Dirk and Nibble storyline, and there's not much of a storyline there. And I feel like I mentioned this on an episode of DDOcast recently, but I really love to see that storyline filled out. Like, we got pieces of it, but like I would love to see like Dirk be this champion of Eberron, or excuse me, of Zendrick, Stormreach, and, you know, like, he's just under, like, a curse spell or a confusion like that, you know, but he's really, like, this really powerful paladin, but he's just crazy because it's, like, cursed, and, like, Nibbles is his, you know, his champion steed who's just been polymorphed into this squirrel, and so you got to find a way to get him out of this delirium, if you will, and complete the storyline that, you know, I'd love to see take us back to Korthos and have Korthos be the end of it all. When DDO finally comes to an end, I'd love to see all of what we've been doing be one giant distraction because there was some, you know, big menacing presence doing something over here while we were all looking over there.
I don't know that you should be pitching the end of DDO. That's a little more.
Well, long term, I'm saying way down, you know, this can all build up to a big conclusion, you know? I mean, this is the 8-year plan.
All right. That could be interesting. Arkat, what do you got for us?
I came up with a few, but probably my number one curiosity, what I'm most curious about is what do the introduction of Dragonborn, what are the implications of Dragonborn on the Lady Vol story? I would like, you know, when we last left her, you know, she, you know, it looks like she just, you know, threw up her hands and got PO'd with us and just left, kind of thing. So I would kind of like to, you know, have her show up again and, you know, sort of explore what the Dragonborn mean as far as her story goes.
Is Lady Vol considered a god?
I think so. At least a you know, somewhat of a god. I mean, she's half dragon, you know, elf. But she got a following as worshippers and all that stuff.
She's kind of on par with Lord of Blades, right?
Yeah, definitely. So as much as he can be a god, I guess she is too.
Right. It kind of strikes me that we've faced, in the game, you face a couple of gods.
Mm-hmm.
And for the most part, they just get ticked off that you ruin their plans and leave.
Yep.
As opposed to like getting ticked off and squishing you under their thumb before they leave. Right? And even like Loth, it's not like we defeat Loth so much as we annoy her and then
she goes away.
Anna comes through at the end and that's the end of it.
Loth was gonna be my second choice. I'd love to revisit that.
Yeah, sure. That would be an interesting storyline revisit. My choice is Drome. Because in part, you guys are kind of looking more at fun storylines. I'm looking more at mechanics and kind of things I'd like to see. That's kind of where I ended up on Drome. First of all, in I think it's the first one in the chain, you see this army of Drome invading, right? Mm-hmm. Like, it's huge. And I feel like that never gets resolved. Maybe there was something in some of the storylines that I missed, but I don't feel like they ever really resolved the fact that there's this giant army that I think they even count as, like a multitude or something crazy, like some large crazy number. They're just, like, hanging out. And, like, the storyline ends is, like, are they still there? I feel like they're still there. So I feel like that's a little bit unresolved and a fairly imminent threat to Stormreach. And so the way I kind of see this going is, I think a fun kind of defense, like a tower defense kind of, I know we have a few of those in the game, but think like Kobold Assaults and Gladewatch Outposts, like kind of those like defending the walls of Stormreach from this invading army, complete with like siege weaponry and stuff like that, just for fun. You know, can you imagine like having waves of monsters coming at you from the army of Drome, and you know they got siege towers to land on the walls, and you've got like rocks coming in from trebuchets or catapults and ballistas coming in. And, you know, there's elements of those in a few places, but I think it can really give. I really want the army, like I'm defending the city against an army kind of feel. Maybe the monsters don't. I'd even think it'd be kind of fun to just have waves of monsters that aren't really your level, like the high level. Wizards can like throw a fireball in there and just like lay waste to entire divisions, kind of thing.
Right.
I'd like to have that kind of epic.
It's really gratifying, you know. Start off with a couple pawn waves. Yeah.
You know, get the fighters going in there and just like one swing of the sword from a barbarian and just like felling foes right and left. Right. It should be really fun to go in that direction. And where I kind of see like a storyline line going, and long-time listeners will know why I'm going here, because I do love this monster, but and I want to see it in DDO. But you know, maybe they're searching for what they think will be a weapon to really break through the wall, so to speak, only to find out that they release the Tarrasque, and then we have to deal with the Tarrasque. So that's kind of where I'd like to go see going. And I was kind of wondering, Voodoo, so you're talking about Nibbles being polymorphed? It's kind of like, what if that was Nat Gann and not his steed? It was his friend Nat Gann.
Wow, you've thought about this more than I have.
Not really.
I like it, you know? I mean, as long as the point is that Nibbles is not just a squirrel, you know, that Nibbles is something significant, that would be really cool.
I think at this point, though, to continue that storyline, I need to go to some druidic place, because I'm pretty sure I sacrificed Nibbles on an altar last time I saw him. So I'm not sure what happened.
He just went somewhere. It's okay.
Yeah. But we'll have to go find him, right?
Yeah, that's part of the storyline. Yeah. but going back to what you said, Patrick, I love it. And I always imagine if that pack ever goes epic, you know, in that first one when you're looking down over the beach and you see the siege weaponry and the divisions that you're talking about,
yeah.
I always imagine that we could jump down there and fight all that, and we keep that, you know, to the tune of that hard rock music that starts playing. We start mowing down divisions of orcs, and yeah, I have always dreamed of the day that we can jump down there and fight all that stuff at once.
Yeah, right? And as like superpowered beings compared to them, right? Like, that'd be fun.
Well, yeah, we're 30th level. We are superpowered compared to them.
I don't know, that'd be fun.
Yeah, and those divisions that we see down there, you know, that can be the fodder that we just mow through. And then, you know, more ships land and they bring the knights and the rooks and the kings and the queens.
Yeah, exactly. You get some tougher monsters in there. They're champions, if you will. They're shamans and stuff. I mean, look, even a somewhat low-level shaman can still kind of catch even a high-level character off guard. You know, everyone rolls ones on their saves eventually.
Yeah, so. Especially on a Reaper mode.
I'm pretty sure the dice in Reaper mode, the dice round down from 3 to 1. I don't know. Yeah, anything else you guys want to say about the story, or maybe some honorable mentions of storylines would be fun to continue?
I've got an honorable mention. I've got the continuation of the Trials of the Archons, you know, on okay. Shavrath. I mean, it would be cool to, you know, either, I don't want to say fight Archons, but be involved with, you know, or have the Archons more involved with the storyline. You know, maybe you know, we ally with them and they actually come and fight with us, kind of thing. Or, you know, and sort of like in Running with the Devils, we have to, you know, go to Shavrath and infiltrate the Archon city, you know, that's sort of the Archon base that's there, and we have to, you know, wind up fighting a few Archons to get at the one corrupted one or something. I'd like to see more on Shavrath, you know, regarding that conflict.
I want to go there too. Now, I'd love to revisit Loth and actually fight her in the Great Fane of Loth, which is like her palace or whatever, that's in the from the classic modules. That always left a bad taste with me that we didn't see that. But I want to go back to Shavrath too, and I want to revisit the storyline that takes place between Heroic Shroud and Tower of Despair. There's always been a hole there that just didn't make a whole lot of sense, you know, where somehow we convinced Harry to help us out. And I always imagine that when Shroud went epic, you know, we might get a part 6 that sort of explained that. Maybe we went through the portal at the end and, you know, we fought Harry in his lair. You know, I'm talking about Eretrekos. We fought Eretrekos in his lair and maybe subdued him, and then he agreed to help us or something. But I'd love that portion of the story to be explored.
The idea, at least what they tried to explain, is that because Eretrekos got defeated in the Shroud, he was being punished. He was in the doghouse, as it were, and he didn't like that. But I don't know. The Devil of Shavrath, in general, that storyline is, I mean, there's a lot of places that you could go there as well. So it'd be fun to see the Archon City, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a place. Yeah, one of my tentative videos that I've been wanting to do for a while now is things that were going to be something in DDO but never were. And this will be like things that are actually in the game that were sort of started but not finished. You know, there's like caves out in King's Forest, and there's all kinds of things. You know, when you go to the Farshifter to take you to Shavroth, there's the selection for Lamania, and there's a selection for... So these are things in the game that indicate like these were going to be something. So I'm not talking about Anorak, where there's nothing in the game that was just outside talk, but there are things in the game. So one of the things, if you look down from Amrath, you can see there's this big complex. It looks like a big stadium and a big like a palace. And if you go, I think it's down around. Hey, puppy. If you go around, I think it's like sort of back behind. I want to say a new invasion, but one of the quests. There's a gate, and you can look through the gate, and there's a long bridge that leads over to that. You can see that complex, that stadium or arena. And the big building, and that gate looks like it was going to be the entrance to something. And I would love to have whatever that was going to be, more of the story. I mean, it looks so cool. And like I said, when you're in Amrath, if you guys have never noticed, like you can look down and see all the different quests. You can see the Tower of Despair. Like you can actually see that stuff from floating up in Amrath, and you can see this complex too. And when you go down in the Slayer Zone, you can get to the gate of that complex and see the complex through the gate. I want to go there.
There's also the cave in Amrath. There's like someone down there said, "No, you're not right. You can't go in here."
Right, the cave of the Enforcer's prison. I totally know what you're talking about. Yeah. Mad Archon, right. And I love that stuff. It's so cool.
I just think the devs and by the way, if you remember from last week, they're looking for a new content designer. I think there's a prerequisite to being a content designer of being like a tease. They seem to like their teases, right? Like, here's this really cool thing. We're not really going to go there. We have no plans to go there. But here's this really cool thing off in the distance.
Well, that just seems par for the course, though. I mean, you know, all these systems that they, you know, it's not just story. It's actually systems, and it seems like, you know, they have this great idea for, you know, for this crafting system or for this. You know, this loot system or, you know, and then it seems like that they just, you know, go away from it and they never fully develop. It seems like not much is ever fully developed. And as much as I hate to say this, because I love the game, but I mean, sometimes I just wonder if whoever is developing this so-called system has said, okay, I developed a system, I'm putting it on my resume, and then that's it. You know, it seems to be just an entry on a resume it, at times to me.
There's some that just didn't, like, they put out and they're not well received. Like the Bounty Hunter system that was here a long time ago didn't really go anywhere. And I think
What is this? Bounty Hunter system.
You don't remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Like, you could go kill named, you had to go find named creatures, and then if you... the named creatures would like drop something, and then you'd take it back to the little post-it board to show that you killed it, and you'd get a little prize.
This must be before my time. I don't ever remember that.
It did not last very long, and it didn't go.
What year are we talking? Is this pre-2009?
Oh, no. This was probably. This was since 2010. I mean, it was.
I don't remember to be honest. It wasn't a long-term thing at all by any means. But, yeah, you know, it's just kind of how it was, I suppose. Let's see. Should we move on to the next question here?
Go for it.
All right. This is a fun one. This comes from Merry Old Soul on the forums. How should the scroll seal shard mechanic be updated? And Arkot, why don't you kick us off this time?
Okay, this one for me was easy. And they started it, at least they sort of did a little bit of it with the desert stuff. So you could trade in any three of the desert scrolls for any single other desert scroll. So I figured, well, you know, why don't we just apply that across all the, all the different, settings or raids. And once again, any three scrolls for any one, and then do the same thing for the seals and the shards. Any three seals for one seal you need, and then any three shards for any single shard you need. I mean, you know, it doesn't have to be three for one. It could be maybe four seals for one seal and then five shards for one shard. But give us a way to convert all the crappy, you know, encrusted gauntlet seals that we have and, you know, and let us get the one, you know, short of shadow seal that we, you know, that we have trouble getting, you know. Give us a way to get the stuff that we, that's all that stuff is out of date anyway. It's not like, you know, getting, you know, a chaos blade is going to, you know, break, you know, is going to break, you know, content, you know. So, at this point, why not? Give us a way to get, you know, this the scrolls, seals, and shards that we need or we'd like.
Okay. Voodu, what are your thoughts?
You know, I want to be real. And I love the idea of trading shards and seals, and I would be all in. If the devs pitched that, and we're thinking about doing this, I would say, hell yeah. But it's never going to happen. You know, there are items that they don't want us to have. That's the reality. Like, they don't want us to have Epic Rings of Spell Storing. Yes, I went right there for the jugular, the Epic Ring of Spell Storing. They don't want us to have it. It's going to cut into their store sales if everybody has what is essentially three major mana pots per rest. It's going to cut into their store sales of pots. They don't want us to have it. They don't want everybody to have an Epic Wolf Whistle. They don't want everybody to have an Epic Sword of Shadows. I don't know exactly what their reasonings were, like, some of that stuff, but in any event, I don't think it's going to happen. But, just hypothetically speaking, I think that this system is confusing for newer players. You know, this is a very dated system. They haven't kept up with the Shard Seal Scroll system, and I think they should just do away with it and have the epic items drop just whole like they do now. So like I said, it's confusing to newer players. There is a lot of newer players that don't have no idea how to make this stuff. And so while, you know, that may be sort of seeming like a little bit of dumbing down, I think in the interest of making it a little more player friendly, you know, I would be fine with totally abandoning it and just have the actual epic items drop in the raids.
And the quests. I mean, it's not just raids that use,
right,
use
that's
the,
true.
The stuff. Yeah, I think those are two of the two great directions to go. I'll propose a third one. And so I like the idea that Arkot's mentioning of, I think it has a noticeable problem, though, in that some players have, you know, years worth of seals and shards.
This guy.
Me?
Yeah. We've got a ton of those. So I think there's a valid concern that if we just they just put that out there, that you would then just, like, flood the market with those items. So I think that, but I like Voodoo, where you're kind of going with the, you know, they just drop, which gives a nice ability to balance what you need for those things, or that you can kind of balance the drop rates so that if you don't want everyone to have an epic ring of spell storing, it's a little harder to get. I'm going to say that the way that I'd like to go is I'm going to pull the newer raid runes concept apply that to not just the raids that have scroll seals and shards. Look, I'd like to see this go to, like, all the raids because I think it's a great mechanic. Better than the 20th completionist, 20th completion run
for sure.
And stuff.
For sure.
And it opens some doors to being able to do some other stuff that I'd kind of think will be kind of fun to do. But put that, use that mechanic on essentially the capstones. I mean, that's usually the raids, but, you know, Under the Big Top and the Spinner of Shadows quest, stuff like that. And as you accumulate raids, and then you can turn in those runes for seals and shards. And maybe there's a little bit of combination with what Arkot's saying, is you need a certain number of these runes plus a couple of shards or a couple of seals to exchange them and then get the one that you're looking for, stuff like that. So that's kind of where my head was going. But I think all three of these would be viable solutions. And really, the big part of it is, you know, it can take forever to find that seal or that shard. I think the nice thing about having the raid rune system, too, is, you know, you might see this content get run a little bit more. Not that some of it doesn't get run, but giving people more of a reasonable access to what they're looking, what they'd like to get out of the pack, in an incremental manner that, you know, they know they can work, they can kind of work towards getting it. You might see people run this stuff a little bit more. So,
1 million bajillion Zawabi shards to get an epic ring of spell storing.
And you know, hey, look, I wouldn't really care if some of the items like the seal, the ring of spell storing and the shard for the ring of spell storing cost more than others. I think that would be an acceptable form of balance.
Mm-hmm.
So I just like the idea that here's the thing I really like about raid runes is you know you're incrementally working towards it. You might pull it, but you know you're incrementally working towards it. Voodoo's suggestion does have a noticeable advantage in that you could then have those items drop with Reaper and Mythic bonuses, which would probably make a lot of people happy as well. So
that'd be neat.
Yeah.
At least for a short period of time. Until they move on to their level 25 stuff, you know.
I feel an obligation to say to the listeners that, you know, the base items, say, for example, the base shadows. My guildie pulled a Mythic 4-1 a couple weeks ago. It was crazy. But if you go to make that epic, the way the mechanics work, like, it literally destroys the base item and, like, creates a new epic item. So whatever Mythic or Reaper property is on that base item is not going to be on the epic. So don't, you know, if you find a nice, like, Mythic 4, like, Sword of Shadows or whatever, don't make it epic. You know, get another one and make the other one epic and keep that Mythic 4-1.
Right.
Because that Mythic 4 will not carry over to the epic version.
Mythic 4 Sword of Shadows, that's kind of nice.
Hell yeah, that's, you know, crazy.
I do want to mention too, like, some these items are dated. They've been around for a while. But there's some really great ones too. Like the Epic Sword of Shadows is a great level 20 item.
That is still a relevant item today. Yeah. That is still a relevant sword.
Bondhead in the chat room is saying he wants an epic silver bow. You know, the epic silver bow and the silver slinger are both actually really good. Even though they're level 20, you can use them effectively for most of epics. Partly because they're blunt; they do blunt damage, and they weaken undead, which is a great thing. So there's some really, and we've mentioned this, the ring of spell storing. Obviously, there's some really great items there that are still relevant and still can be nice, quote, twink gear for your level, your epic past lives kind of stuff.
Someone in the chat room is talking about the red dragon scale, you know, from Bond 5-6. Like, that's really good. Like, especially, like, the heavy version, that's the only, like, level 20 heavy armor available to a druid. So, like, I love to use that on a druid, but that's really hard to get.
It can be, yeah. There's definitely parts of it that are hard to get. That you got to find that red dragon shard. So,
yep.
All right, let's move on to our next question, and this comes from Cold Brewer on Sorlona. What is the best raid for small guilds? We'll go a lot of directions for this, and I'm gonna go with Reaver's Fate / Fall of Truth. They're different raids. Fall of Truth is kind of the quote epic version of Reaver's Fate. It's not exactly the same, but it's kind of similar. The reason why I went with these raids is, one, they're in a very popular pack. Almost anyone's going to get Giant Hold. If you don't have Giant Hold, it's probably one of the top three, if not two, packs that you should get. You know, Veil of Twilight and Menace of the Underdark are I think, kind of right up there. But it's one of the best packs that you can get in the game. The other thing I like about this is the raids are much more doable with a smaller group. Fall of Truth a little bit less so, but you don't have a lot of roles happening simultaneously. You don't need to split the party in 10 different directions like in Temple of the Deathworm. There's a puzzle at the end of Reaver's Fate, so you need to have someone that can do a puzzle. But it's a fairly easy puzzle in terms of the grand scheme of things, and you can get solvers and stuff like that. But they're not long raids. You can run them fairly quickly. So you don't, you know, if you've got a small group of people and maybe people are playing with a short amount of time, that can work really well for you. They're not overly complicated. There's a lot of nuances in Follow Truth, but you don't really need to know them all to make it work. And they're fun. I've always enjoyed running them. I kind of miss running Reaver's Fate. It was a lot of fun back in the day. And as a bonus, you don't have to reflag in any way, shape, or form. It's not complicated for flags. There's a few quests to run, but you're probably going to run them anyways. So that's what I got. What about you guys? Voodu, why don't you... What raid do you like?
I'm going to go for Demon Queen. So I believe there are some assumptions to make in this question. This was a listener question. So if it's a tiny small guild, I'm assuming this is not a tiny small guild full of ballers. You know, sure. That this is maybe like a more casual guild, maybe with some newer players. And so I really like Demon Queen as sort of like a first raid because it's a very simple raid. You know, you got a simple riddle that you can use a solver for in the pre-raid that you got to run every time. And the raid is very simple. If you just have two or three people, no problem. You can start. You know, if you're new to it, maybe you're really casual. You just don't have. You know, you start with. You know, take your epic tunes on heroic normal. And when you're like, oh, this is way too easy, then work up heroic hard, heroic elite, epic normal, epic hard, epic elite. But you can build up, and doing this together as a smaller guild is great team building. There are some still fun and relevant items that drop from that raid. So, I mean, not only do you have a chance at, like, uber gear, like Epic Ring of Spell Storing and Epic Wolf Whistle, but there's also some other really nice stuff. Like the Torque is a really unique and amazing, like, situational item for a lot of casters. And then you've got the Staff of Arcane Power, which is a really nice, like, utility staff. It has, like, a lot of, like, situationally valuable... It has a spell selector on it, so a lot of those are situationally valuable. So there's still some pretty nice items and interesting items that come from that. It's easy, and it can be, like I said, a great way if you're a smaller or tiny guild, great way to sort of, you know, build a sense of team and, you know, start working together, and then from there you can move on to other raids. It's also a great raid. If you're interested in soloing raids, I highly recommend Demon Queen being your first raid to try to solo.
Yeah. Arkat?
Okay, well, I'm going to go for the what I think is the easiest one to pick, and that's Tempest Spine. Tempest Spine is the one that everybody has access to. It's also relatively straightforward. Really, the only time you have to divide up your party is when you get to Fire and Ice. And even then, that's pretty forgiving. As far as, like, you don't have to kill both the fire guy and the ice guy at the exact same time. So it's relatively easy raid mechanics themselves. But, you know, they've also got some pretty nice items, low-level items. You know, assuming you're doing it at level 10 or level 8, whatever the level is. I mean, there's some fairly nice low-level items, you know, throughout the chest, like... You know, the Cloak of Invisibility is in Atchkar's chest. And there's the Gleaming Adamantine Plate. I forget whose chest that's in. But, you know, there's some relatively nice items throughout the raid, you know, depending on which, you know, rare person or rare monster is there. So, you know, it's very accessible. It's pretty straightforward. It's got some pretty nice low-level loot in it.
Yeah, it's good. I mean, it's almost more of a quest than a raid. I mean, it's mm-hmm. definitely a raid, but I mean, there's no flagging. It's probably the hardest part of Tempest Spine is figuring out where you got to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
True.
Man, I remember being lost in there as a noob.
If you've never been in there and you don't know where you're going, bring a guide. You can get lost in there pretty easy.
Tempest Spine's a good choice.
It is a great choice. To be honest, I kind of overlooked it because I know it's a raid, but I always kind of forget that it's a raid.
I also want to, you know, just look. I'm always looking out for my druids out there. Like that, you know, there are some choice items. And from the heroic Tempest Spine, you've got one of the lowest level named sets of non-metal medium armor in there. The Enchanted Dark Leaf Breastplate, or the, I forget. There's two of them that have this like the almost the same name, and one of them's metal and one of them's not metal. But I like to use that on my druids. Like it's a level 8 medium armor. Like I said, it's the lowest level medium armor option for a druid.
Yeah. All right. Those are great choices. There's a few others too, but Fire Peaks would be a pretty easy one for a small. There's not a lot going on in there. Be another good option as well. Probably not Abbott.
Abbott's not Abbott. No.
A good one for a small guild.
You know, I almost went there too because, like, it can be like that. That would be amazing team building. You know, like if you work together, figure out the puzzles, and you can just go in. You know, if there was just like four of you, you could go into each puzzle sort of individually. It's going to take you some time, when you figure that kind of stuff out as a guild together, it builds a great sense of community.
It's a good point.
And that really has a great, you know, that it builds your guild. The spirit of the guild, and that really goes a long way, that morale.
Yeah. And it is doable. It has been soloed, which is kind of mind-boggling when you think about it. But it has been soloed, so you don't need a ton of people necessarily. Just a lot easier with a full party. You know, you can figure out which of your guild or the troublemakers, you know, when they get the goggles and they lead you to your death and stuff like that. So, all right, we'll move on to our next question. This came from Gamorad on Twitter. I might have asked this before, but we're gonna pitch a racial completionist. So we just got racial reincarnation. So exciting, a lot more options. My apologies to the people who really like having triple completionist of, and that's what makes them feel like they won the game, and you now have 30 past lives to look forward to.
Suckers.
Good luck. We wish you the best.
No sympathy from me.
Please,
no, Patrick, none. Gives you sympathy. Please, none from me.
Please consider to allow me to tag along in your speed DRing groups when I'm at the appropriate level. So we got racial reincarnation, and that's pretty cool. We thought it'd be fun to... What does racial completionist look like? We'll start with Arkat.
Racial completionist is not needed. And the reason why I say that is if you look at the benefits, you know, anything from the skill points to the extra stat points to the 10, action points that you get for a racial enhancement tree. I mean, the end result looks a lot like the regular completionist result, regular completionist feat, if you will. And it doesn't cost you a feat to do. And you get the 10 extra, you know, action points. So in some senses, it's way better than the normal completionist status. So I don't think we need to do anything more to create, you know, a proper quote unquote racial completionist.
Okay, sure. Voodu, what do you think?
I appreciate that argument because I've been hearing people make it that, you know, that if you sum it all up, it sort of looks like the heroic completionist already. We do have to spend a feat for that. So that is one different. I think there's got to be a carrot at the end. I think there's got to be a light at the end of the tunnel to make people chase it. So I think if for no other reason, that's why there has to be some sort of racial completionist. Otherwise, people are just going to be like, I don't need this dex pass. I don't need this repair pass. I don't need, you know what I'm saying? So put an incentive to do them all. And it doesn't have to be something earth-shattering, you know, but what I'd like to see is the ability to twist, to sort of quote-unquote twist an enhancement from a different race than you're playing. So you're playing, you know, a drow, but you want to twist in, like, the greater heroism enhancement from the human tree, that you can use a different racial enhancement. You could twist in a racial enhancement from a different race than you're playing, just one, and that's what you get for racial completionist.
It would be an interesting tech to see how that plays out and how to do that. But it's an interesting idea. I went pretty simple and not very creative. I just figured a bonus feat. just to represent all of
oh,
the...
Oh, man. Yeah, I want that. Forget what I said about twisting it. I want bonus feet. Yeah, give me that. Give me that.
I figured it's fairly easy to implement. It's a good reflection of your past lives of learning. And there's plenty of feet-starved builds.
So
I think it would be a pretty juicy carrot, as it were. And like I said, it'd be really easy to implement. So
I could taste that carrot right now. Oh, man. That's what
I'd like to add deific wording to at least a couple of my tunes.
So I'm talking like a level like at creation feat. So you're not going to get like a legendary feat out of it. But just, you know, I have to caution you, Voodu. Right now, that carrot is a lie. It doesn't exist.
Oh, I know, but in my dreams it does, and that's where I'm going right now.
I don't know. It didn't strike me as horribly creative, but I figured it'd be...
Oh, I love it, dude.
A lot of people would really, really go for that, so... But yeah, I think... No, I like... I do want to acknowledge Arkot's point, too. And like, do we need it? That's a fair question. I think 10 action points to spend... Like, 10 free action points, that's... I mean,
that's huge.
Like,
that's an amazing thing.
Yeah.
To have, I mean, depending on what kind of build you have, what you are, or what race you are. I mean, there's some great things in a lot of the racial enhancement trees.
I want to gripe here though, because the first tier is a skill for everyone, and human gets haggle. Come on, seriously, all the other ones are something that's useful to some. Haggle? Who really cares about that? That the obvious choice there was perform. Humans should be perform, not haggle. Come on, guys, change that.
Yeah, perform is a nice little skill to have.
Yeah, for bards, for any spellcaster that does...
Your Fae Pact Warlocks, like, right. Higher performs, absolutely.
Form was the obvious choice. Haggle, come on now.
Sure. There are some other ones
Sorry, Patrick, I've got a beef with the current. And this might be the best time to talk about it, is racial completionist, the beef with the... You know, why Dragonborn get plus to charisma? Shouldn't they be getting plus to strength? Because then you can, when they add Aesimar later, you know, you get the, because there's only one race that gets a plus one to their wisdom.
Aesimar is going to be wisdom.
And yeah. So Aesimar be wisdom, and then you should make the tiefling the charisma one, because they don't get a plus to strength. So, you know, because right now there's only one to strength, and that's orc, rather half orc. So make the Dragonborn, you know, the plus one to strength. So now you have the plus, you know, you have two races with plus one to strength, just like everybody else. And then charisma for the tiefling, and then wisdom for the Aesimar. Seems like the perfect way to do it.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you. There were certainly some ones that were a little different. Like, why? I think someone was asking Steelstar in Lemania or something about why are humans wisdom? Well, no one else was.
Right.
is kind of the answer. So, I don't know. Yeah, it does definitely seem like Aesimar would be obviously a wisdom choice, and Tiefling would be kind of an obvious charisma choice. So, interesting to see what they do when you get there. Because I don't think you can change it. At that point, you can't change Dragonborn back to strength. That would just be unkind to players.
They should do it now. I mean, they should. You know, the next patch or whatever, they should make that change. And before everybody's gotten used to the fact that, you know, for that charisma point, you got to go. You know, you got to go Dragonborn.
I mean, it's probably too late, anyways. To be honest, it would be less of a painful ripping of the Band-Aid off. But I mean, I think it. That ship is sailing. You're kind of in trouble either way.
I like it though.
But maybe we'll just hope for another race that'll be strength race. You know, up the ante a little bit. So,
half giant.
There you go.
Minotaur. Minotaur.
Or what about the Goliath?
The Goliath. Yeah.
Although they're a large creature, so that it could be kind of interesting. Although it would be kind of fun to actually play a large creature. It could be interesting. But if you do that, then I think you got to add something that's what's under small, tiny. It'd be kind of fun to play like a pixie or something like that. But that's a little further down the road, I think. And I should mention too, you know, when I'm pitching a bonus feat, I mean, you lose the feat if another race comes out, so kind of keep that in mind. All right. I think that'll bring us to our last question for today, coming from Alan Wee, for Thelanis. Pitch a warlock themed epic destiny. And let's start with Voodu.
Well, I'm going to go right for my favorite destiny of Unyielding Sentinel. And a lot of people are probably going, really? Come on. But here's the thing. Reaper mode's tough. Okay? And Unyielding Sentinel adds wonderful survivability.
I should probably stop you. I think you misunderstood. We're talking about a new destiny that's warlock themed.
Oh, crap. I came totally unprepared. Okay, I need to go last here.
Arkat, that's okay. Arkat, what do you got for us?
Okay, I got a couple, actually. One of them is kind of crappy, and I just found it in Dragon Magazine 366. It's called Radiant One, and it has a lot to do with, you know, light. You know, so you have some immunity to light damage, and, you know, any kind of power that you had with light was amplified, so it would be useful. But then I thought about it, Enlightened Spirit's kind of like that. So, you know, and then that, but that's a, you know, that's not an epic destiny, but I figured, you know, that would be one way to look at it. But another one that I thought was better was something called, you know, that I'll call Pact Lord or maybe Pact Master. And it would be something similar to, you know, to Draconic Incarnation, where you could like pick a pact to re-emphasize. So let's say you were a great old one in your heroic life, and you took an epic destiny, and you were going to be the pact master, and you were going to choose a great old one path, you know, kind of like how you can, you know, choose the blue dragon path if you were a draconic incarnation. But, you know, it would make your goo stuff a lot better. You know, you do more acid damage if you wanted. Or if you wanted, you could even take an additional pact. Let's say you were a great old one, you know, and heroic, and then you got into, you know, the pact master, and you decided, well, you know, I'd like to kind of, you know, supplement or augment my Eldritch Blast, you know, with, not only does it get acid, but I'd also like it to have Sonic. So you could, you know, get like a secondary pact, you know, a fey pact, as long as your alignments were compatible. You could, you know, have basically two pacts. And so I thought that would be a kind of an interesting way to, you know, for a warlock to, you know, continue down a destiny of its own.
Yeah, so I kind of, this is actually a little harder than I thought it was going to be. Because it was kind of which structure you want. Because you think like Grandmaster of Flowers, it's very, very monk-centric. Mm-hmm. And there's not really a lot there for people who aren't actually a monk. But most of the other destinies, at least, you know, there's a lot of stuff there that you can get for other classes. You know, Magister isn't very martial-friendly, but you know, there's still some stuff there. So I kind of landed on this idea that it would kind of mostly be towards warlocks. And kind of some similar ideas of you can kind of pick at the start what kind of, like, what pseudo pact are you going with, right? Like the idea that you're committing towards a deity like a warlock does, and you get some stuff based on that. Some bonuses to spell DCs, I think, would be appropriate based on which one you choose. I like the idea of you know, splashing in a little extra light damage. You know, like it does kind of borrow from the Enlightened Spirit. There we go. Thank you. It does kind of borrow from that tree, but, you know, adding some light to damage when you hit things with a weapon or an Eldritch Blast, or even some spells, I think were appropriate. And you gotta remember that not everyone that's going to be in this tree, most people that are going to be in this tree, aren't going to be a warlock. So having some of that stuff, I think, is okay. I kind of went back and forth on having an aura, And I kind of don't. If there was an RO, we wouldn't want it to be quite like the one from Enlightened Spirit, but maybe a little bit of bonuses to, like kind of a quote a stance, like stances kind of idea. Maybe you have an RO that's doing a little bit of damage. Maybe you have an RO that's doing a little bit of buffing of yourself, and kind of that kind of a vein of thing. But then I thought it would also be kind of fun to have a few spells that you can get based on what pack you picked. Not high-level spells, but you know maybe this gives some martial characters an opportunity to cast some spells. Maybe they're spells that aren't in the Warlock spell list per se, so maybe we can give them a couple extra spell options, or even other casters a couple spell options and have a little bit of fun with it. So. Are you ready, Voodoo? You ready to go off the cuff here?
I'm so ready.
All right, let's hear it.
I got this. Okay. I don't know what the heck it's going to be called, but okay, so there are some really cool things that are in the Warlock trees now and some themes that I would like for them to build on in a Destiny. And so I'm not going to think about this in terms of how much is it going to benefit, you know, non-Warlocks.
Sure.
You know, that's we can figure that out later. But so along the innate line, I'd like to see something that says, you know, you get 1d4, you know, sort of pack damage to your Eldritch Blast and Burst and to your ranged attacks too. Let's say, for example, that way it gives it a little bit for other kinds of other classes. And then in the main part of the enhancement tree, obviously you're going to have a charisma line up the right. I'd also like to see a damage type line so that, you know, you can add certain or convert, like right now it's like Utter Dark Blast and I think it's called like Penetrating Blast changes your force damage to piercing and it changes your force damage to evil damage. So I'd like to see a line that has like that kind of thing, changes the type of damage that you're doing that I can select on the fly based on, you know, what quest that I'm doing. You know, I want to do this kind of damage instead of that kind of damage. Selector on the fly, and then another line that adds augmented abilities to your burst and blast. And it can be to ranged, you know, to ranged attacks too, for example. So like right now we have like Bewitching Blast and we have, you know, different kinds of things that add abilities to our blast and burst. So I'd like to see those kinds of things build up a line so that we can augment our blast and burst. And then I'd like to see an SLA line too. So right now in a theme, especially in Tainted Scholar, you can get extra spells added to your spell book. I would like to see a line in an Epic Destiny that does the same thing, that adds spells to our spell book. That's what I got.
Yeah, there's some great, great fun ideas there, I think. At least the building blocks of what it'll be. I was thinking while you're talking, it would be kind of fun if there was like a vampirism thing for weapons, maybe, or because there's a little bit of that like sucking your own life kind of a thing in Warlock theme.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be kind of fun if you could pass that on to other monsters, right?
And tier 5, my my tier 5 at the top, or is it 6, whatever. We'll finally get like sort of an energy burst for Sonic. I'm going to have that right now.
Oh,
well,
cool.
I guess we sort of do in Primal Scream, which I love. I mean, if you've never used Primal Scream on a Sonic damage kind of a, you know, a tune like a Fae pack, you're doing like well over 5,000, and plus it gives you the bonuses to strength and con, so it's a really cool, you know, tier 1 twist. So take a look at that.
Yeah, that could be fun. Well, there you go. There's our debate episode for today. We'll get into some other stuff, but that was fun. Thanks to the listeners for providing the questions. There were some fun things to look into there. Let's talk about game news. Of course, Update 35 came out this week. Now that I'm actually reading that part of my notes, I can tell you definitively that it came out this week. I don't have to rely on my memory that's completely fried right now. So Update 35 came out. Two new quests, one of which was broken upon release, but they hotfixed that to work. Did you get it? Anyone get a chance to run the new raid yet?
Yep.
Nope, but not unfortunately.
Got two guild completions so far.
Nice. Give us a spoiler-free impression. Did you like it? Was it fun?
I liked it. A lot of people are just, a lot of people are going to complain about anything they come out. I like it. It's gorgeous. It is totally beautiful looking. The scenery is beautiful. There is, there's some repetitive puzzles, but, it's going to be kind of thing. And the devs came out and said this, like, it's the kind of thing that once we figure we get more comfortable with it, we're going to send teams out to do those puzzles and sort of everybody will have something to do. I like the end fight. I thought there was, it just felt different than other raids that we have. I like some of the things that are going on. I think, I'm not crazy about the raid loot. I wish it was better, but I do enjoy the raid.
That's good. I tried to run it, but I had the misfortune of the one day I really got to log on since it came out, of logging on right after most of my guilds had just spent like 3 hours in there getting pummeled.
Yeah, so we spent over 2 hours in there the first night, and we did not get completion because there were some basic mechanics that we didn't understand. Mm-hmm. And I want to give props to Omnipresence for doing that Legendary Elite, world's first completion, because I watched that and I got some tips, and I asked a question about what they were doing, and I appreciate them responding because that helped us get our first guild completion. I also want to say, like, the Blue Dragon, which is the boss, is gorgeous, like, just absolutely beautiful. To look at, and other spoiler free, you got to have energy sheath, the electrical version in there, period, even on normal. And also, it's important to say that, like, the devs have already acknowledged, like, that the boss, I don't know if it was the mobs in general, because I feel the mobs in general, like, on normal, they have too many hit points, and the devs have acknowledged this, I think they have said that they are going to ratchet it back a little bit, because on normal, it's tough. I mean, that first night in my guild run, and we were all 12 guildies, and we kept saying to ourselves, this is normal? Really? Like, I feel bad for pugs going into that raid. It's going to be a freaking nightmare. Some of my guys were like, this seems like, the difficulty's bugged, and maybe this is Legendary Elite difficulty, because it just seemed like the boss and everything had way, way too many hit points.
So when can we expect the High Lords of Malkier teaching raid?
That's going to happen. That's going to happen this year. So we've almost worked through every raid in the game the first time, and then we'll do it all again. And so by the end of round two, if you will, so later in the spring, we're going to do that as a teaching raid. We may not be able to have like six newbies in there. We may only be able to have like two or three, but you know what? Maybe we'll run it back to back or something. Okay. Yeah, that's going to happen. Like, I'm already to a point where, like, I want to do a live stream and talk about how it works. And, I'm only having done the raid three times, I'm already, thinking, like, yeah, I want to do a teaching raid of this.
Cool.
But I want to get a better, like, I want to understand as much as I can before we actually go there.
So you're referencing what so Torque came in and posted on the forums. He said, thanks for posting. He's been dying to get some feedback on this thing. Because let's face it, some people go to Lemania, but way more people are going to step into this thing on the first day it's live than will step in 4 weeks of it being on Lemania. So,
somebody, I will say I'm not happy about death timers on normal. There should not be death timers on normal. A death mechanic is fine. And one of the things that somebody, the person that had a big sort of critique on the forums, one of the things that they suggested is that if you die like on the main platform, that your soul stone gets sent to like sort of down below, and then that somebody has to go down and get you, kind of thing. I think it's a neat death mechanic that avoids the death timer thing. I don't like the death timer at all, not on normal.
So he went through some feedback point by point. So he said the hit points are too high. He completely agrees, particularly on the dragon. They actually cut them a bit after Lemania testing, but didn't cut them enough. It will be corrected soon, and the only excuse he can offer is the wide range of possible builds you guys can put out, put together makes it really hard to accurately predict your power level. We haven't done a raid in a while, so we erred high, which is probably the best. They've said that they prefer to err high, and it makes a lot of sense. So there we go. The raid's major push on the puzzles was designed with the hope that the groups would split up the puzzles work fairly evenly as to be the most time efficient in finishing the run. He suspects that this may eventually be the case as you master the raids, other mechanics, and get more confident splitting up into smaller and smaller groups. The puzzles are meant to be fairly accessible to anyone and are also in locations that people can access outside of a raid run if they want to practice. That being said, they're still collecting feedback, and if the horse is getting beaten to death here, he can't promise anything extensive will change, but a puzzle here or there may get swapped out as they figure out how deep the problem is. There are a few wrinkles which he's not going to reveal that really help almost anyone navigate the eye phase of the raid. Electric absorption, hit points, and self-healing help, of course, but the smaller teams you can work in, the easier it is not to take any lightning hits in general. However, he sees that the rest areas allowing the few to do the work of the many, they'll look into that. As far as the death timer, a while ago they decided the res timers were a good balance on raids dead for creating a, quote, window of time a raid could wipe in, but if they could stick it out through the window, raids dead, people could get them back up to speed. Raids and Reaper are meant to be tough stuff, and this has worked generally for us in the past. Being dead generally makes for a touchy subject no matter what mechanic you use. I do like your point that normal is not, I mean, they have the established paradigm of not having a death timer on normal for raids, so that
right.
makes a lot of sense. The XP, he'll look at it. The raid wasn't expected to run as long, which is part of the problem. The XP will likely go up, but there will also be some work to make the raid run a bit quicker. Let's see, other stuff he said. So they asked about new puzzles. Variety is the spice of life, he agrees, but he can only say maybe if there is time in the immediate future. As far as the storm mechanic, it would be more cut and dry to say three strikes and you're out, if I'm following you correctly, but the current mechanic does give you advantage of to people who build against it, and he likes to reward folks who actually chase down all the toys that are out there. I think that.
Can I give another non-spoiler tip for the new raid? Okay, so for those of you who've done the new quest newcomers, there's like a Simon Says kind of puzzle in there where, you know, the rune's blinking and you have to repeat the pattern. And so there are lots of those in the new raid. And so you get, and there's also, you get struck by lightning a lot. When you get, if you're standing in front of the puzzle and you get struck by lightning, the lightning is just blinding. And, you know, if you're trying to look at the pattern and a lightning strike happens, you miss it. So what you want to do is just step back from the puzzle like a body length or so, so that you can still click on it, but you're a little bit back, and then turn your camera angle at about a 45. So that way when the lightning strikes, it's off to the side of the puzzle and you can still focus on the puzzle. So step back. Angle 45 degrees one way, and the lightning strike won't get in the way.
Yeah, which is I would say that you know, if you find this, granted I haven't been in there, and it seems like they're gonna make some changes, but don't freak out too much about how, quote, hard the raid is. You know, these things do get easier over time as people more and more people learn how to do it. But I will say congratulations to the devs for designing a raid that seems to be taking people longer than they thought it would take, because usually that's not the case.
It's like I said, I enjoyed it. There are some like sort of basic quest mechanics that when you don't know them, it just seems like crazy hard and it takes forever. But you know, that first night, like I said, we spent over 2 hours in it. The second night, like, it seemed so much easier. Just knowing like two or three basic quest mechanics made all the difference in the world. And like I said, having energy sheets and electrical was a giant help too.
Then that, I mean, that's pretty basic of every raid too.
Right.
Some of them have easier mechanics than others, but I can tell you from experience, the first night Fall of Truth came out and we went in there on Epic Elite.
Oh my god.
And we got creamed. It did not go well, and it's not.
Didn't know about the boom, did you?
That is not the boom. Wasn't even working. I don't even
think
we got
that right. far. That's right.
I got one more good tip, Patrick, and it's a non-spoiler.
Go for it.
There is one shrine in the raid, and on normal, shrines can be reused. So, like, we've been going back as a team, like going back to the shrine. And you can even like send a team or one, you know, self-sufficient person. Even during the end fight, you can step away and go use that shrine and get your mana back and come back. So just know on normal, that shrine is reusable. Every, what was it, 15 minutes on normal?
15, yeah.
Yeah.
So. All right, some stuff on racial reincarnation. The bonuses from the racial past life feats are granted at level 1. Attribute bonuses from racial past life feats do not impact your ability to qualify for feat prerequisites or your skill point pool. Sad, but there you go. They apply to character level 1 and grant all in-game bonuses associated with having higher ability score modifiers, DC calculations, plus hit and damage, hit points, all that stuff. Except you can't use them as prerequisites during character creation or level up. So there you go. So it'd be similar to an item, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
Steelstar wrote about making new items. What he said was they love to make super unique off-the-wall items when they can. Unfortunately, time and the need to complete other features doesn't always allow us to do as many as we'd like. Believe me, as the dev that currently making items, I always want to make more of that sort of loot. As it goes, there are 4 new effects in this update, loot that are brand new and do not appear anywhere else in DDO, not including insight and quality sources for some of those things which also appear. There are a few effects here as well that only appear on 1 or 2 other items. The setup for these sorts of effects on their end is building us toward the ability to save time when making stat items, which is good for both us and players. It gives us more ability down the road to do more of what you're asking for, again, when they can. Just to note, in particular, each item of the caliber you're talking about typically takes as long as making all the loot in Update 35 did. I think he was asking for stuff that's really, really unique. And typically when they've done updates with fewer but more, quote, unique named items, it's not been received as well, often because such items are typically only applicable to a narrow range of builds or somewhat complicated in their use. Also, and I thought this was kind of fun, in the interest of transparency, he wrote, the Gibber's Blade was not originally intended to work in raids. It was a bug that did that upon release. However, like many of DDO's more broken things, powers that be at the time decided they should leave it rather than nerf it, to the objection of this loot designer. It's a cool item, and one he's glad is in the game in one form or another, but dang, it's incredibly destabilizing to the difficulty of DDO raids as a whole.
And I call BS on that.
Yeah,
that it's destabilizing?
Okay. Most people, most people don't have a Gibbers. But there are a few people that have, you know, that have at least one, if not more. Maybe they'll have one on 4 or 5 different characters. That's not my real point. My real point is that, yeah, okay, so somebody has one, and if they use it, if the chances are that if you wiped to begin with, you know, using a Jack Gibbers during the raid is not going to necessarily save the raid. You're probably going to wipe again. So I don't think that Gibbers is as destabilizing as Steelstar, would have us believe.
Okay, I got something to add to that too. You know what's more destabilizing to raids? Lag. Okay. Seriously. That's when we use our Gibbers. When we lag wipe, that saves it, because I'm telling you, when people lag wipe a raid, especially when you get all the way to end fight, that is infuriating. Mm-hmm. And Gibbers gives us a way to save that. And the devs are saving themselves a world of headaches because we can use that in raids.
I completely agree. It's definitely there. Now, I will say that I think there is still some truth to the idea that it does kind of change a little bit on when you're trying to plan for difficulty and stuff. Now, having said that, I like using it in raids. It saved me a couple of raids, and I completely lag wiping in a raid is one of the most frustrating things I have gotten to points where I have literally stopped playing DDO and gone and cleaned my bathroom.
I have been there.
But I think I do want to acknowledge that there is some truth that you know, that's there, and how there is a question of what does that do in terms of designing content from a challenging perspective. I agree. I think Gibber's Blades probably, other than lag wipes, are generally just going to cause players to spend more time in a raid that they probably should leave anyway, like restart anyways. Because you do have things like death penalties and resources that start to really kind of accumulate at that point, so.
I want to plug Gibbers here since we're talking about it, okay? Because I know there's gonna be a lot of people listening that don't have it and like, oh, it never drops. Oh, like ever since that item came out, like, immediately I recognized, like, how huge this was to save raids, to save a quest, etc. Okay, and I have been on this ongoing campaign to get every one of my guildies, and one of them's watching right now. I see you in the chat. Every one of my guildies, a Gibber's Blade on every one of their alts. Like, that's obviously, you're never going to get there, but, like, that's the goal, okay? And we've had so many of my guildies pull these things. I mean, like, every time we go on a raid, like, half my guildies are going to have it at least, because we've made this a priority. And here's the thing. Don't get discouraged, folks. This is one of the best XP per minute quests in the game, so this should be part of your daily routine anyways. I mean, you can run it on Epic Elite in 15 minutes, but even if you can't, you know, like, you can run an Epic Hard or Epic Normal, or maybe it'll take you a little bit longer. Like, when I did my Northwind True First Life series, no ship buffs, first life, no past lives, blah, 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 blah. Like, I did Epic Elite Gibbers on that True First Lifer solo. You can do it. And like I said,
you don't have to do it solo either.
Right, right. And if I can do it solo on that True First Life or no ship buffs and no twink gear and blah, 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 like, you can do this. And like I said, it's one of the best XP per minute quests in the game. So keep doing it two every day. That's over 100,000 XP right there in a half an hour.
Yeah, I've been doing that a bit. Not every day, but it kind of is in my back of my mind that I try to do two a day. Which has a nice thing of, if you only do two a day, it doesn't, and you're not super hardcore about doing it every single day, you know, something comes up and you don't get around to it, it doesn't feel like I get burned out on it. And I will say, too, the music in there is, like, some of the best anti-burnout music you're going to find. It's so relaxing. It's just kind of like you come back and you're like, relax mode. It's not quite smooth jazz, as Lesa would put it, but it is as close as pirate music is going to get to smooth jazz. So, yeah, there we go. And you know, you're right. It seems like it doesn't drop as much as you would like it to, but it does drop more than I think people realize.
Mm-hmm. You will get it. You just got to keep running it.
I had a great stretch around Christmas where I saw 8 drop in like 16 runs.
No way.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I walked away with 4 of them.
I had a guy join, you know, who joined our guild like last year, and he was like, "Oh, it never drops, it never drops, it never drops." But once he joined the guild, he got into that, like, that this campaign of we're running it all the time, and he got like 6 in his first month in the guild. I'm not kidding. That's not an exaggeration.
Yeah, no.
And he still says it doesn't drop, and I'm like, "Yeah, really? You got it on like every tune now. It doesn't drop, huh?"
Wow. I have one. I have 18 cap tunes, and I have one.
So. I have it on every one of my tunes.
I'm working
but
on
I only
it.
Have,
I'm
like, 5 there. Tunes that I play.
I got 14. I'm down to... I got 8 of them covered so far, so... But, yeah, I mean, it takes commitment, but it's a nice, easy thing. It's not hard. I've been doing it on Reaper 1, and it's, you know, it's not very hard. It's kind of a nice thing to kind of get... You log on... Throw up an LFM and maybe find some friends. And like I said, it's once you start doing it, it's a pretty easy quest.
If it's not too hard either, do the vampire optional. That's like 15K right there.
Yeah. Bonhead wants to know if it's bound to a counter, bound to character. It's bound to character. It's also exclusive. So you can only have one. Yeah. And hey, you know, if you have it, and your friends are running it, help them out. So, the sooner your guild is done running it, everyone has it, the sooner you guys can do other things, right? You know, I don't know.
I would encourage every guild leader out there, or every officer in a guild, or every leader in a guild, to embark on this campaign for your guild. This is such an important item. Every tune that you're serious about, it should be a goal to have it on that tune, because it can not only save raids because of lag wipes, but also, you know, you just die in a quest, especially in Reaper mode now more than ever. Yep. Jack Gibber's Blade is so important because Reapers hurt and you're going to die. And the Cursed Blade of Jack Gibber's is a minimum level 1 item. So get it.
You can use it all the way
across. Your guildies get it.
Mystic Dragon Rider is also mentioning that there's collectibles in the quest. And there are.
That's my guildie right there. She's part of that campaign.
Let's see. Bonus days. 20% bonus to Heroic and Epic XP through today, March 19th. Store stuff. The new items. So you can get the Dragonborn is new item, and there's the new quest And new racial reincarnation hearts. They are true hearts of blood, I think is what they're called.
Mm-hmm.
And so we didn't cover this earlier, and I've seen this question a lot this week. Hearts of blood, so racial reincarnation, everything is the same as true reincarnation, except for the feat that you get for doing it. So what that means is you can't be an iconic character. You have to be a normal character to use those hearts. You get them in the exact same manner. You can get them with tokens of the 12. By the Tower of 12, you can get them from the store. Like, all of that stuff is the same on how you find them and how you get them, how you acquire them. I know that's been a question I've seen a lot. So they cost the same as true hearts in the store and for tokens of the 12. So it's essentially the exact same process as you're used to for true reincarnation. The only difference is you get a different feat. The sales for the week. The Honor of Your Guild sale through March 23rd. So you can get 20% off of Astral Shards, Guild Renown Elixirs, 50% off of Guild Charters, and Guild Airship Beacons. You can also get a Lesser Treasure Hunter's Elixir with the coupon code DRAGONLOOT. An appropriate one there. Do you guys use Airship Beacons?
No, I don't. I probably should, though. They're pretty handy at times.
I don't, but I have one guildie who refuses to walk anywhere. And it doesn't matter if he's in the middle of the market coming out of Hound of Zoriad. He throws up an Airship Beacon because he will not walk 5 feet to get to an airship entrance.
Hey, you know, there you go. that's kind of funny, though. So it's a good week for him. Community news. We'll start with the 229th Chronicle of the Week. Seiki takes a new journey through DDO's heroic levels. Nude in this case means no items equipped or spell components or guild buffs with past lives and epic past lives. So basically take all your gear off, which would be fun. Ginger Spice has a Reaper survival guide. That's fun. You want to give us the 30-second version?
Yeah, sure. So Ginger Spice's survival guide to Reaper mode, 20 tips. Okay, so I did a 1 to 30 life, and so I'm offering you people that are a little bit newer to Reaper mode, I got 20 things in there, everything from the basics to stay together and work as a team and don't zerg to here's some specific items that are going to be really helpful. Like, for example, the petrifying runestones that you can craft really cheaply that a lot of the player base don't even know it's there, and you don't need high crafting levels to be able to do it. These are awesome in Reaper mode, at least in heroics. So my sort of one of my stretch goals when I made that video is that even if you've been playing Reaper mode from day one, that in these 20 tips there's going to be at least one morsel that is something new to you and helpful to you that you didn't think about. So if you're newer to Reaper mode, or maybe you're totally new to it, or if you just run a few Reaper quests, I promise you, these tips in these videos is going to help you be more successful in Reaper mode. And I'm working on potentially a 20 more tips video.
The advanced tips.
The advanced Reaper tips.
The Reaper tips. Reaper mode tips.
Mistwalker in the chat room has a great tip, too. A cheap Reaper beater is a Ghost Touch Incorporeal Bane weapon, which doesn't require much in terms of crafting. So it's a great tip. It'd be a good item to make for that. Let's see. Hives of Malkira had their teaching raids last night, Reaver's Fate, and
Follow
Also Truth.
Me.
Did you win?
Hell yeah, we won.
Yeah, good raids. See, Joffrey is organizing a March of the Bears on Caneth. We talked about that last week. He's advocating for, or they are advocating for dyes for wolf and bear forms. So, be interesting. Although I would have concerns about, would you have to reapply it all the time, or would it?
That's right. Every time you change,
Would it persist or not? See, the guild for the week, Arcane Alliance, has a new leader. It's an Orion-based guild. Recently nominated Ultimax to lead the guild, so the former leader could focus on work. The guild has quite a few completionists and is interested in new members. You can find them in-game. Say hello. The comment for the week, what is a Dragonborn's favorite breakfast?
Halflings.
bacon. I feel like bacon would be the obvious DDO answer, right?
They all have Special K with banana. And if anybody gets that reference, props to you. I know there's at least one DDOCast listener that knows what I'm talking about.
Let's see. We got a shout-out for last week where we discussed shields and orbs. If you're looking for shields or orbs, you could go for that. Mystic Dragon Rider saying pickled cobalt toes for tracking bar. That's a good one.
Tasty.
DDO Players News had their 122nd episode. DDO Gamer likes his top-hatted frog. Enrique wrote about his runs over DDO's 11th anniversary. Minion Monday is getting ready for their next raid on Wayfinder. Mickey hit week 20 in her Legendary Elite and Epic Elite raiding effort. Even though Grant achieved a long-term loot goal and Grimord wrapped up her Paladin lines, you can all check out all those blogs. Let's see. Cordovan was on Epic, running Epic on Kyber in the newest weekly Wednesday live stream as well. That kind of covers all that stuff. Notes to Strike a Chord had his 12th opus. He was talking about wearable gear. You can check that out. And DDO Gamer talked about reincarnation. talking about racial reincarnation as well. I think that pretty much covers that. So we can get into our lightning post. So we had Fuzzy Duck wrote in regarding some shield stuff. Kind of pointed out his favorite shields. He mentioned Talon, which I don't think we mentioned. Well, I remember seeing it in the chat room. It's a DPS shield rather than a defensive. It can hit like a truck in the hands of a Vanguard. I feel like pretty much any shield's going to hit pretty hard in the hands of a Vanguard. It's kind of their point, right? But yeah. Definitely some of them are going to be better than others. He likes Death's Door. It looks great if you want that Death Knight appearance and absorbs death effects. Gave a shout-out for the Deathic Runestone, which Voodu, is, as the resident druid expert, is probably like one of the best druid shields in the game.
Yeah, it's really awesome for a caster druid. Yeah, absolutely.
And for wolf form and bear form, too.
I don't know anything about that melee stuff.
He gave a shout-out to Stonewall and Epic Stonewall from Terminal Delirium. They're stone, unlike almost any other tower shield, so they're non-metal. So it can be used by druids. Splash Fighter, there are two levels of Fighter, or Fighter for the level 2 proficiencies, and combined with Dragon Scale Plate, you get a huge amount of durability with an elemental Nuki Caster Healer. And it has expanding crit range and Flesh to Stone effect on. So he mentioned Bastion, which I feel is kind of gone by the wayside a little bit, which is why I didn't mention it. At the time, it was a decently nice defensive and offensive shield because it had some PRR on it, but now PRR is a lot more ubiquitous. So, he also gave a good shout-out to Purple Dragon Knight Shield. He also mentioned that if you take Improved Shield Bash, which we didn't talk about, so you can bash while you're blocking, which in this case gives you the orb bonus as well, which is a great tip. And he also mentioned that Madstone Aegis is also not a metal tower shield, so you can use it for druids there as well. Let's see. On orbs, he mentioned that Thunderforge and Golden Orb of Death are non-gems.
Metal.
So that's important. They can't be used for druids. Also, Energy Siphon, it isn't when you get hit. We got this wrong. It's when you hit an enemy with it. Which seems kind of useless to me. I don't think of many people hitting things with orbs.
Nope.
So there you go.
Hey, Patrick.
Yeah.
If I could interrupt real quick. Has there been any kind of consensus or has anybody come up with a real reason why we cannot, there's no such thing as a craftable orb yet?
I think they just haven't done the tech for it, really, is kind of the thing. There's not really, for rune arms and orbs, there's not a... you can't get them randomly, either. Rune arms, I'm sure it has a lot to do with how they work and how they function.
Sure, sure.
Orbs may be a similar thing. So if it's... like, if there's a lot of tech... specialized tech to make them work individually, then you wouldn't see them very much. But I don't really know the answer to that.
Okay,
you're talking about Caneth crafting, though, right? Because you know there's obviously
Caneth crafting. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Because I'd love to make some Caneth crafted orbs for sure.
Right. There's a question in the chat room from Bondhead. Does spell power help with damage? Yes. Any of the powers, like melee power, range power, spell power, increase by each point that you increase that percent. So 1 point of power is 1% more damage. The thing you have to be careful of with spell power is it gets a little confusing because there's so many types of spell power. So force spell power does not apply to fire spell power, right? But there's universal spell power, which will apply to all of your spell powers, but it's the same channel as force spell power, so it just takes the higher of the two. It's kind of the short version of that.
He's new, so I want to make sure that we're clear that does spell power help with damage, such as force spell power with force damage? Yes, for your force spells,
right,
but not like force damage that you're doing with like a weapon, for example.
Correct.
So I want to make sure that he understands that, he or she.
And pay attention to enhancements and stuff, because a lot of them will say like they do damage, or some of them are actually healing, but stuff happens based on a certain amount of power. A lot of times, melee power, and you'll see something that says, like, this does scales with 200% of melee power, which means you would double your melee power when applying it to this. So, sometimes it's less than that. If you look at warlocks, some of their blasting types, they scale down the force power.
So,
there's some stuff like that. I also like Becca Bloomers is making an observation from Reaper that some folks are joining Reaper 4 and 5s that really have no business being there. Know your limitations and play within it. Yeah, and remember too, you know, not all quests are created equal. Some of them are not too hard to do on higher Reaper skulls, and some of them are a lot harder to do on lower Reaper skulls. I know that I did Lords of Dust shortly after Reaper came out. We did Lords of Dust on like Reaper 3 and mostly did okay. And then we went into Servants of the Overlord on Reaper 3 and got about 5 feet into the quest and got completely green. So not all quests are created equal in that. The best advice I have, yeah, you know, is try what you think you want to try and adjust accordingly. If you don't find that you're running through Elite easily, you know, I would not recommend going in on Reaper 5.
Right.
Maybe try Reaper 1 or 2, sure. But if you're not doing it easily, you know, don't scale up too hard. Might not work very well for you. Our survey question for the week comes from Lessa, who is from the Damsels of DDO. And she asks, halflings or gnomes, who wore it better?
I beg your pardon, who wore what better?
Do you like the looks of gnomes or halflings better?
Oh, I like halflings better than gnomes, I think.
Why?
You know, the gnomes just, for some reason, just bother me when I look at them. I mean, their features are more pronounced, you know, so, you know, they at least, you know, I think there's probably a bigger degree of difference between one gnome and another, as opposed to one halfling and another, but just, you know, just in general, I find the gnomes, or rather the halflings, a little bit, you know, more pleasing in appearance. But of course, the absolute worst out of all of them are the half elves. They're just the creepiest looking out of all of them.
Voodoo, what do you think?
Gnomes are just so cute. I mean, I love gnomes. I mean, they have the big cute noses, and they're just adorable, and I feel like if they were real, they would be so sick and tired of people going, "You're so cute." You know, I love the gnomes. I think they look awesome. And this is coming from someone who, you know, I've been playing pen and paper for years, and gnomes were always like the butt of every joke. And when I started playing DDO, I was surprised that the community wanted gnomes so much, because I thought they were like the joke in Dungeons and Dragons. So I went into gnome with a lot of skepticism, but when I saw them, I was like, they're so cool.
Yeah. don't know. My problem with gnomes is more the deep gnomes. They're kind of creepy looking.
I love it. I love their eyes.
They look a little possessed or something.
Yeah, they do. They like the girls look like little like horror, like 5-year-old horror movie girls, like from The Shining or something. Like they're terrifying, but I love it.
Yeah.
They have their own unique sense of like adorability. Is that a word?
Yeah, there you go. All right, let's close out the show. Voodoo, do you want to talk about your channel and what you got there? And I noticed someone was asking for something that you have a video on.
Yeah, so somebody's asking about, like, is there a beginner's guide video for the new can of crafting? Yeah, so that's exactly what it is. I walk you through it. It's for beginners from the start. And make sure you read the comments in the video because there's important supplemental information in there as well. But, yeah, so if you guys don't know me, I have a YouTube channel with I'm getting close to 500 videos, and these are all, like, instructional, like, quest guides, like, raid guides, like, crafting guides, walkthroughs. Virtually every one of my videos is narrated. I include like lots of tips to help like newer players. Like I'm not a power gamer. This is not like a power gamer min-maxing kind of a channel. Like I try to keep it real and be helpful as I can in my videos. Right now I'm posting a lot of videos of Voodoo doing and that's my warlock doing Reaper quests. We've also, this year, we've been live streaming our teaching raids. We're doing these teaching raids where we bring in new players and teach them, first timers in these raids and teach them how it works. So if you're not on, if you're on Sarlona, get involved. If you want to learn raids, this is a newbie-friendly environment. It's really awesome, low stress. But if you're not on Sarlona and you want to learn these raids, we're live streaming them. And we got people, like 20, 30 people every week watching these. And a lot of them are learning along for the first time. And I'm answering questions as we're doing it. I also and posting first look videos for the new quest, newcomers in Black and Blue. We already have the live stream up of newcomers, and we already did the first look video for Black and Blue, which I'm going to try to edit and post today or maybe tomorrow. And then in about 2 weeks, I'm going to debut my next series, which is going to be the Ginger Spice Dragonborn series. So look for that.
Ooh, Dragonborn, huh? Nice. Arkat, anything you wanted to plug here?
Yeah, I just wanted to say my wife is fairly new to DDO. She played way back with us when it was in, when it first came out, and then she stopped for a very long time. And they started getting back into it about a year ago, and she really appreciates the Ginger Spice videos a lot. So they're evidently very, very helpful for new people. And just based on my wife's responses to them, I would definitely recommend that to new players and maybe some of the less skilled players, could learn quite a bit from them. I also wanted to talk about just briefly Dragonborn and how much I'm really digging Dragonborn, and I'm hoping, Patrick, that you'll have a show dedicated to Dragonborn at some point, because I really look forward to at the very least, looking, watching that show. So
amazing.
Love them. I love them.
Yeah, a little tease on where we're going with the cast is I'm trying to put together a series on casual gamers, kind of directed more specifically towards tips and stuff for that segment of the population. So that'll probably be coming up in the next week or two. We'll be starting that and have a couple episodes on that. We'll probably continue got one more episode for gearing stuff, and then we'll probably go back into maybe do some races or something like that. But in any case, thanks for listening to the show. Thanks for all the folks in the chat room for chiming in and asking some great questions. And thanks to Voodoo and Arkat here for joining me today, especially early in the morning, at least for me. And thanks to all the other contributors for DDOCast. It's great to have all those folks helping me out and making the show entertaining and not me talking to myself and bringing in some great ideas as well. Thanks also to Standing Stone Games for making DDO happen and keeping it alive, and thanks to Wizards of the Coast as well. And thanks to Cyberbridge for hosting the podcast. If you'd like to support the show, you can visit our website, DDOCast.com. There's an option there that you can support us financially. Or you can also support us financially on Patreon if you want to do that. All that money goes towards prizes. I am planning on doing some more prize-heavy stuff later this summer as well, so look forward to that. You can hit us up at DDOCast.com for our show notes, MP3s, our calendar, previous shows, swag, and other fun stuff. If you'd like to be part of the show or have a comment on this episode, a question you'd like to hear us answer, something you'd like to hear us kind of debate about and talk about or pitch some ideas and stuff like that, send me an email at DDOCast@gmail.com. You can also just comment anywhere you can find this or shoot me on Twitter, all that fun stuff. Our closing tip for this week comes from Remin on Thalanus. As a new player, take toughness. Once you get used to the game, you can switch it out if you want. Great
easy tip. Feat.
Yeah. You can, if you don't know, you can get a free feat exchange by doing the Hallmark quest, which you can do every life, I believe.
Yes.
Nice little fun, easy thing that you can do. In any case, until next time, may all your attack rolls be crits, all your chests level appropriate, have fun, and don't forget to gather for buffs.